So our next contribution is from the Laboratory for Machine Tools and Production Engineering of the University Aachen, Germany. And the authors are Christian Brecher, Simon Pieske, Adam Malik, and Simon Storms. The paper is entitled Modeling of Devices in an Adaptive and Dynamic Environment. We are looking forward to your presentation.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to my talk about how we imagine modeling devices in an adaptive and dynamic environment. First of all, I want to give an introduction to the project we are currently working on. The ICER Factory is an interdisciplinary project incorporating the expertise of engineers and biologists. The idea is to build a platform for cultivation of induced pluripotent stem cells. It will enable biologists to implement and test new automated processes for the cultivation of cells, without concerning themselves with engineering part of such a project. This means that the main goal is that devices have to be able to be taken out or inserted into the ICER factory without great effort or reprogramming the whole facility. In the picture, you see a robot responsible for all material transport within the ICER factory, a centrifuge in the back, a microscope, and an incubator. There are also currently some devices present which are not visible on the image. There is a liquid handling unit in the back, which is responsible for transportation of fluids between vessels. There is also a second microscope and a rudimentary storage space for carriers. Because cells are living organisms, their growth can't be strictly planned, so the process control has to adapt to those variations. It must also be capable to react to the changes in the processes implemented for various reasons and changes of the hardware. This presentation especially tackles the requirement for exchanging devices. To reach this goal, a traditional approach, as shown here, will not lead to the desired result. As soon as we exchange a device, and if we leave all hardware constraints of this aside, the control system does not know how to interact with the new device. In addition to this, the execution system has no information on how to incorporate the new machine into the given processes. This challenge must be taken up and solved by the control architecture. The idea is to separate the actual hardware from the representation to the execution system, so a kind of abstraction layer must be implemented. Before we can start to develop our new architecture, there are some key elements we had to keep in mind so that our new architecture works as we want it to work. We have identified two main tasks the device model has to conduct. Firstly, it must model the current state and the structure of a device. The state model must express where carriers or workpieces are currently located within the facility, whether any resources are missing and need replenishment, or where exchange points are to insert anything into the device, and how the different building blocks of a complex device are related to each other. The state model must provide a defined way of accessing the information. There is no point in having all this information stored somewhere without the ability to be used by the execution system. Lastly, it needs to provide three different kinds of properties. The first ones are properties that are exchangeable during runtime and don't have a fixed value at start time. They have to be stored persistently and loaded while loading the state model. The second ones are properties that change during runtime but are set to a fixed value when the state model is loaded. They do not need to be stored permanently. The last types are constant values that don't change during runtime and have a fixed value at start time. The second task the device model must address is that it needs to describe the operations a device provides. This description has to come along with the respective restrictions and constraints. The execution system will be unaware of the underlying hardware. Therefore, device-specific optimization must be carried out by the abstraction software that runs the device model. To provide the execution system with the necessary information on how to improve the optimization further, the execution model must provide information about it. Lastly, the minimum requirement for available operations of the execution model is that it needs a way to insert and extract work pieces or necessary resources into and out of a device. The approach we took to enable the exchangeability of devices is that we provided each device with a matching and specific control software or agent. Between the execution system and the control software, the defined agent interface can be seen. It is equal for all different devices. Between the control software and the different devices, the machine interface is shown. It can be different for all devices, as the main task of the control agent is to map the machine interface onto the agent interface. If a device is exchanged using this approach, the control agent is exchanged together with the device. By utilizing the provided information of the device, the execution system can use it to carry out the manufacturing processes. Let's have a more detailed look into the planned software architecture of a control agent. It will consist of two main parts, the kernel and the driver. The kernel forms an outer shell of a device agent. It itself is unaware of the actual device, but it provides, for example, the interface for the execution system and the persistent storage system. It also enforces a fixed software architecture of the driver part. The kernel is the same for all device control agent and doesn't need to be re-implemented for each device. This means all the software infrastructure that is shared between different devices can be implemented in the kernel. The driver is the device-specific part of the device control agent. It provides an interface to control the actual device. The driver is dynamically loaded by the kernel during runtime. It defines the state and execution model of the device too. Then it presents those models to the kernel. The splitting up of the control software leads to a faster implementation process. The kernel provides all necessary interfaces so we could focus on implementing the actual necessary parts for controlling a specific device. To meet the requirement for the state model, a graph-based approach is taken. In the upper picture, a simplified UML diagram of the representation of a microtater plate, an MTP, a standard vessel for cultivation of cells is shown. In our case, the actual MTB combines six wells which hold the actual cells in a single part. The lid of the MTP can be independently taken off the MTP. The relation between these physical objects is represented by the relations in the UML diagram. The lower diagram shows how this representation of an MTP can be embedded in a device structure of an example device. What can be seen there is that devices can be represented by a tree-like structure, starting at a root node. In this example, the root node has two children, a gentry and a storage unit. Those in turn can then be split up even further. In the structure, the lid and main body of the MTP are stored on different storage positions, so it can be concluded that the MTP is currently open. For simplicity reasons, the wells are omitted in this example. The necessity to model an open MTP while also keeping the relation between the lid and the corresponding plate is also one of the reasons why rigorous tree structure is not feasible here. Relations can span between siblings within a graph. As is already hinted, the relations between physical objects are modeled by relations between nodes in a graph, while the properties of a physical object are modeled by the properties of a node. A node in the graph can be accessed by starting at the root node and traversing all the edges in the graph in a specified order. This path can be represented by a list of elements which is similar to a file path in a computer system. This representation is, of course, not unique. Various different paths can lead to the same node. But when you follow such a path, you will always reach a well-defined node. So, how was the device control software implemented? First of all, the whole kernel as well as drivers are implemented in .NET environment by Microsoft. More specifically, in C#. The interface to the execution system is implemented using the Windows Communication Foundation Framework, a standard framework of the .NET environment provided by Microsoft to handle inter-process communication. The storage backend for the software is implemented using MongoDB, a modern open-source NoSQL database. To manage the communication within the control software, between kernel and driver, a hooking mechanism is implemented. The driver can provide messages to the kernel, which are called at specific points of the runtime of the kernel, so that the driver can react to those changes in a lifecycle. The locking mechanism is connected to the hooking mechanism. It provides a way of locking the device to help preventing race conditions if many operations are called simultaneously. Every time a device is locked or unlocked, the respective hooks are called. This in turn can be used by the device for optimizing execution tasks. Another optimization technique are bulk method calls. The execution model provides a way of expressing that a method can be called with multiple parameter sets simultaneously. This allows the driver to optimize and reorder those calls in the most optimal way. This can happen with regards to time and or resource usage. So, let's have a look whether the requirements have been met by the described control software. The inner state and structure has been modeled. By providing a traversal path of the state graph, the informations are accessible. Properties are made available by the nodes in the graph. The types are implicitly given. Operations are provided as a list by the execution model. Various methods for optimizing tasks in a machine-specific manner are implemented. Extraction and inverting workpieces are doable by the software agent. So all in all, it can be seen that all requirements are met. What are further developments which must be implemented? Firstly, the state model is stored in a database for each device. Regarding the need for a single source of truth, this is not optimal. So we need a state graph describing the whole facility. This again enables the global handling of carriers and workpieces. To reach this goal of a global database, the handling of the circular references emerging from the graph structure must be tackled. It is not necessary but recommended to replace the communication technology by a more standardized way of communication, so that the agent is not restricted to a single framework provider. Also, this architecture should be transferred to a more traditional production process so that it can be evaluated there. So, at last, I can just say thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Simon, for sending us this video. For those of you who has just turned in, we are on the live stream 2 of the CIRP-E Global Web Conference 2019, and we're going to have a discussion with the corresponding and presenting author, Simon Pieske, from the Laboratory for Machine Tools and Production Engineering of the Technical University in Aachen, Germany. Simon, can you hear us now?
Yes, I can hear you.
Great. Thank you for your contribution again. I have two questions based on your presentation and paper. The first one is, could you give us a bit more detail about the overall goal of your work, as well as what are the consequences of this approach?
Yes. Thank you for your question. The overall goal of this project, or this part of the project of the ISO factory, was to model possibly any devices which are which need to be in a production facility. Of course, this project was is based on the cell production.
Okay. You just mentioned that it's a part of a project, and we know from your paper that it's an acknowledged project or funded project by the German National Science Foundation, which is called iCell Factor. Could you give us a bit more information about the whole project, about the positioning of this paper within your research?
Okay, yes, of course. The iCell Factory is a cell production facility where the goal is, or the final goal is, to have a regular production of induced pluripotent stem cells. iPS cells are a type of cell which can be derived from adult human cells. So you can basically make stem cells out of adult tissue. And there are like stem cells, they can be used for regenerative medicine and specialized medicine. So we have basically a the idea is to make specialized medicine for each patient. So we have basically a patient-based medicine.
Thank you for your answer. It is interesting for us to listening and later on reading your paper, because it is a kind of unique presentation within the this year's CIRP-E conference, where you build a kind of transfer between biotechnology and production engineering. Say some words about the chances of this transfer, but as well as about the challenges of it?
Of course, the challenges are this specialized product, so that each customer, to get more in production terms, gets its individual product, and to make the processes which are really dynamic in cell production, you can't plan in a far future, you have to plan step by step. So these are the challenges we have to overcome when we want to transfer this idea of a customer-specific product into the traditional production technology. But this is also the reward we want to get. So that the customer of the machine or a more consumer product comes to us or comes to the manufacturer and gets a specialized product for him.
Thank you. Since our audience is more from the research perspective of production engineering, could you give us some examples of industries, sectors, or products which could be already transferred or which is on your pipeline to look at in future work?
There is no specialized product currently in the pipeline, but maybe you could think about, for example, car manufacturing. Where it's a highly it's a highly diverse production now, but you can think of that for example you can individualize each car for each customer, for example, as an example.
Okay, and coming back to your project iCell Factory, do you also collaborate with medical institutions in this research?
Other
kinds of institutions?
Yes. Yes, we do. We have a collaboration with the cell biology of the University Hospital in Aachen. And we have a collaboration in some terms with the Fraunhofer Institut also in Aachen currently. Fraunhofer Institut of Production Technology.
Okay, thanks a lot. I think further information can be found on your website.
Of course.
And in other publications. So thank you a lot for your time and giving us a bit more information about your project.
Yeah, thank you too.
See you soon. Bye.
See you soon. Bye.